This is a second part of India in the 18th century, in which we are going to learn about rise of regional kingdoms. In part 1, we have learnt about causes of decline of Mughal Empire. For reference, link of part 1 is given in the description. There were many regional kingdoms were there which broke away from the Mughal Empire and began functioning as practically independent states, about which we will learn in detail. Here I will give brief recap about the chapter. After the death of Aurangzeb, Mughal power began to decline. The later Mughals ruler did not have the economic or military capabilities to hold the vast Mughal Empire together. The invasions of Nadir Shah and Ahmad Shah Abdali considerably weakened the Mughal Empire. Here I'll give introduction about the rise of independent states. As a result of all these factors which we have explained for the decline, many regional kingdoms broke away from the Mughal Empire and began functioning as practically independent states. Disintegration of Mughal Empire, political vacuum filled by several independent and semi-independent regional powers, some rebelled against Mughal authority, while in others the governor took advantage of the situation and asserted their independence, rise of regional powers. As I said before, the decline of Mughal Empire led to the emergence of numerous strong regional independent and semi-independent powers who started to assert their authority. These included Bengal, Awadh, Hyderabad, Mysore, and the Maratha Kingdom. These powers attempted to challenge the rising British power in the second half of the 18th century. While some regional powers established autonomous administration under Mughal suzerainty, others openly rebelled against the Mughals and asserted their independence. Let us now take a look at some of the provinces that emerged. First, I'll go with the Hyderabad. Muhammad Shah appointed his wazir, that's called Prime Minister, Chinquis Khan as a governor of Deccan in 1722. He was given the title of Nizam-ul-Mulk. He established the Kingdom of Hyderabad in the Deccan in 1724 and ruled in a semi-independent manner. Then, while he never officially declared his independence from the Mughals, he began to rule the state of Hyderabad independently. Asaf Jah established an efficient administration which helped him to consolidate his power. He protected his state from internal conflicts and external threats, particularly the powerful Marathas. He also attempted to get rid of the corruption in the revenue system. After his death in 1748, the state of Hyderabad faced a war of succession. The political instability in the kingdom made it easy for the British and French companies to intervene in its affairs. We'll go ahead with Mysore. The state of Mysore emerged as an important and powerful kingdom in South India under Hyder Ali. Hyder Ali, a soldier of Mysore army, he established a powerful and modern army and was also considered a good administrator. In 1769, Hyder Ali defeated the British in the First Anglo-Mysore War. After 2 years of fierce battle, the British were forced to enter a treaty of mutual defense with Hyder Ali. During the Second Anglo-Mysore War, that was in 1780 to 84, Hyder Ali died and was succeeded by his son Tipu Sultan. Tipu Sultan was popularly known as Tiger of Mysore. He was an innovator, a brave commander, and ardent fighter against the rising British power.
Tipu introduced several administrative reforms. He also attempted to build a modern, efficient and disciplined army. The state of Mysore flourished under the rule of both Hyder Ali and Tipu Sultan. It was only after the death of Tipu Sultan in the Fourth Anglo-Mysore War in 1799 that British, assisted by the Marathas and the Nizams of Hyderabad, occupied the state of Mysore. Like the governor of Hyderabad, the governor of Bengal, Murshid Ghali Khan too, owned loyalty to the Mughal Empire only in name. He added Bihar and Orissa to his territory and shifted his capital from Dhaka to Murshidabad. Murshid Ghali Khan was succeeded by his son-in-law, Shajauddin. He was a charitable, just and impartial ruler. Shajauddin died in 1739 and was succeeded by his son, Sarfaraz Khan. He was a brave man but of a religious temperament. His belief career ended in 1740 when he was deposed and killed by Aliwardi Khan. Aliwardi Khan, who was earlier the governor of Patna, became the Nawab of Bengal in 1740 and ruled for 16 years thereafter. Sirajuddaulah, Aliwardi's favorite grandson, ascended the throne after him. He was the last independent ruler of Bengal. However, the Nawabs of Bengal failed to assess the increasing influence of the European trading company and did not curb their growing military preparation in Bengal. In 1757, Sirajuddaulah was defeated by the British force in the Battle of Plassey. After the war, there was a gradual increase in British power in this region. Sadat Khan, the Mughal governor of Awadh, founded the independent kingdom of Awadh. He was an able administrator who strengthened his army, maintained an efficient administration, and introduced several revenue reforms. Sadat Khan was succeeded by his nephew Safdar Jung, who was appointed as the Wazir of Empire in 1748. He waged wars against the Rohillas, Jats and Marathas. Safdar Jung was succeeded by his son Shajauddaulah. The third Nawab, Shajauddaulah, was defeated by the British in the Battle of Buxar in 1764. Now we'll go further to learn about another strong power. While the Mughal Empire under Aurangzeb had lost the loyalty of Rajput rulers, it was after Aurangzeb's death that the Rajput state took advantage of the growing weaknesses of the Mughal Empire to free themselves from the central authority. The major Rajput states of Jaipur, that Amber, Jodhpur, Mewar and Udaipur, Mewar asserted their autonomy. However, the Rajput states were themselves involved in conflicts with each other and failed to form a united Rajput entity. The English East India Company took advantage of internal factionalism among the Rajput states to further their interest. After the invasions of Nader Shah and Ahmad Shah Abdali, Mughal power in Punjab was greatly reduced. The Sikhs began fighting against the Mughals under the guidance of their 10th Guru, Guru Gobind Singh. His disciple Banda Bahadur continued the fight till the time of his execution in 1716. After a period of fighting among themselves, the Sikh established a powerful empire in the 18th century under the kingship of Ranjit Singh. Ranjit Singh was an efficient administrator, skillful diplomat, and courageous soldier. He built a well-equipped
efficient and disciplined army organized along European lines. In 1809, Ranjit Singh signed the Treaty of Amritsar with the Governor General of English East India Company, Lord Minto. The treaty recognized the Sutlej River as the boundary between the Sikh Kingdom and the British territories. The British promised not to interfere in the internal affairs of the Sikh Kingdom. Here we'll learn about one of the important and most strong regional power, the Marathas. The rise and growth of the Marathas under Shivaji and his successors played an important role in the history of 18th century in India. Shivaji was greatly inspired by his spiritual guru, Guru Ram Das. He taught Shivaji the importance of Swaraj, or freedom for the Maratha people. It made Shivaji determined to free his country from the Mughals. Shivaji began his conquest from the age of 19 by the time of his death in 1680. Shivaji's kingdom comprised the whole of the Konkan, the area between the Western Ghats and the Arabian Sea, and extended from the south of Gujarat to Ponda, that is near Goa. It included the Belagam, that is Belagavi, Satara and much of the Kolhapur region of the Deccan Plateau. Along the east coast, he held Gingi and Vellore. He also held Kopal or Bellary, that is Ballari, to the west of the river Tungabhadra. After his death, the Maratha kingdom became a battleground between the Marathas and Mughals. Sahuji, the grandson of Shivaji, who had been imprisoned by Aurangzeb, was released by Bahadur Shah in 1707. The Maratha state at that time was ruled by Tarabai, the queen regent. A civil war broke out between the two. Sahus was victorious. The Marathas became so powerful under the second Peshwa, that is Bajirao I, in 1720 to 1740, that they were able to collect their taxes unchecked by the Mughal governors. In 1737, the Maratha army defeated the Mughal forces near Delhi. Balaji Baji Rao, 1742 to 1761, the third Peshwa, made the office of the Peshwa hereditary under him. Maratha power rose to its peak. The Maratha armies overran most of India. Delhi was captured in 1753 and Punjab was seized in 1758. Balaji Baji Rao further extended his empire in different directions. Maratha power reached its height under him. The Maratha soon reached Delhi and offered their support to the Mughal emperor. The expulsion of Ahmad Shah Abdali's agent from Punjab brought the Marathas into an open conflict with Ahmad Shah Abdali. The battle between the two forces was fought in Panipat in January 1761. The Maratha were completely defeated. Nearly 28,000 soldiers were killed. The Peshwa died in June 1761. The Battle of Panipat destroyed the possibility of the Maratha emerging as the strongest power in India. For the British, this battle was of immense significance. The Maratha defeat cleared the way for the rise of British power in India. After learning about regional powers of India in 18th century, we note that the Indian powers were strong enough to destroy the Mughal Empire, but not strong enough to unite it or to create anything new in its place. Possibly the Marathas alone possess the strength to fill the political vacuum created by the disintegration of the Mughal Empire, but they lacked political vision and succumbed to the British power.
Thank you so much. We'll be back with another chapter.